So the slide says sympathetic nerve fibers stimulate the heart by stimulating the SA node. We know that the SA node begins the conduction throughout the entire heart. So you stimulate the SA node, you're going to stimulate the whole heart. There's also circulating humoral agents, such as epinephrine, that circulates in the blood, and that stimulates the heart to beat more often. On the cells of the heart muscle, there are receptor sites, and they're called beta 1 receptor sites. And you learn a lot about this when you're learning about drugs that treat bronchospasm in the lungs. Because sometimes they'll stimulate the beta 1 receptors in the heart and make the patient become really tachycardic. So this is the background for all of that. So when stimulated, the heart rate increases. And that's referred to as chronotropy. So chrono means number, so our rate. So a positive chronotrope would increase heart rate. So it says positive chronotropy, or you could use the word achronotrope. So a positive chronotrope stimulates or increases heart rate. So what do you think a negative chronotrope would do?
Decrease
heart rate. Parasympathetic nerve fibers, no, I skipped one. The force of contraction can increase, and that's considered inotropy. And we're talking about the force of contraction. So a positive inotrope would increase the force of contraction of the heart. So positive inotropy increases the force of contraction of the heart. And negative inotrope would decrease the force of contraction. So if there's somebody who has really high blood pressure, do you think they would benefit from a positive inotrope or a negative inotrope if their blood pressure is too high?
A negative
inotrope. That way the heart contracts less strong and the blood pressure will be lower. If somebody has a heart rate of 40 per minute, blood pressure is really low, becoming diaphoretic because they're not getting enough perfusion, would they benefit from a positive chronotrope or a negative chronotrope? Positive chronotrope. All right, the last bullet says parasympathetic nerve fibers also innervate the SA node, and that acts to slow the heart rate. So you've got sympathetic nerve fibers, parasympathetic nerve fibers. So it's all part of the autonomic system to speed things up, slow things down. And all you have to do is identify which one does which. So parasympathetic innervation to the heart, does that speed it up?
Slows
it down. So what speeds it up?
Sympathetic.
The normal heart rate for adults is between 60 and 100 beats per minute. So that's at rest. And of course, when you're exercising, moving around, you've had some Starbucks coffee, it's higher. Heart rate will increase to increase cardiac output. And I think that statement's going to mean a little bit more to you when I give you the formula for cardiac output. We talk about what causes cardiac output to go up and down. So we'll let that be for the moment. A heart rate greater than 160 beats per minute does not allow proper filling time and the cardiac output falls. So greater than 160 per minute, the heart isn't taking much time to fill before it's contracting already. So can you imagine somebody with that fast of a heart rate and you take their blood pressure? The blood pressure isn't going to be 120 over 80. Because the heart never had time to fill to eject enough blood to cause that high of a pressure. So the pressure will be lower. Do you need to write anything else to that, or does that make sense? Mm-hmm. A rate greater than 160 beats per minute does not allow proper filling time, and the cardiac output falls. Do you want to write anything else down for that?
Leads to low blood pressure.
So then be low?
Yes. Blood pressure will be low. Sinus tachycardia for the adult, it's greater than 100 per minute, so I guess 101 up to 160 is considered sinus tachycardia.
160?
Yes.
So greater than, can you read that?
Yeah, 100 to 160 beats per minute is considered sinus tachycardia. So if you're given a heart rate of 100 on the test, because I know this is what you guys are thinking, you're given a heart rate of 100 on the test and you have to identify it. Is that considered a normal heart rate or is that considered a sinus tachycardia?
Normal.
It's normal. What if it's 101? I never intend to do that to you, but just saying. Sinus bradycardia is a heart rate less than 60 beats per minute. Sinus bradycardia less than 60 beats per minute. So this is just the beginning. So when you have your cardiopulmonary diagnostic class in the spring, we talk about, all right, the heart rate is 50, but maybe 50 is okay for the person. So what do you assess? And then you look at blood pressure, are they neurologically okay? So they have no symptoms, maybe 50 per minute is normal. So you don't have to treat a heart rate of 50 per minute. So that's where this leads eventually, but not now. All right, now we're going to look at cardiac output. The definition for cardiac output is the volume of blood ejected from the heart in 1 minute. And it has to do with two things. It has to do with the heart rate. You want to write down HR stands for heart rate, or is that a given? Do you understand that? And then SV is stroke volume. Stroke volume. And then you need to write a definition for stroke volume. It's the volume of blood ejected from the ventricle. So stroke volume is the volume of blood ejected from the ventricle. When the heart contracts. Normal stroke volume is 60 to 130 mLs. 60 to 130 mLs.
On what?
60 to 130 mLs.
Is that each time or treatment? That's each time.
It's just the volume during each contraction. That's how much blood leaves the ventricle. So not per minute. In order to find out how much per minute, then you'd have to multiply by the heart rate, and then that would give you the volume of blood per minute. So if the heart rate is 100, and the stroke volume is 60 mLs, what is the cardiac output? Heart rate is 100 per minute. You can write like example on your paper and write heart rate 100, stroke volume 60 mLs. And the question is, what is the cardiac output?
6,000
mLs. Now convert the 6,000 mLs into liters. 6 liters.
So the answer is always in liters, right?
Or no? Yes, and with the neonates and the small children, no, but with the bigger kids and adults and leaders. And the formula doesn't always present itself like that. So heart rate and stroke volume, cardiac output. What if you were given the cardiac output and you were given the heart rate, but you weren't given the stroke volume? Do you remember how to change the formula to get the answer? What's that?
Solve for X.
Yeah, like solve for X. Would you know how to do that?
Mm-hmm.
Let me give you one and see if you can figure it out. All right, so the cardiac output is 8 liters. The heart rate is, let's make it easy, 100 per minute. What is the stroke volume? So you're going to have to convert the 8 liters into mLs. So 8 liters is how many mLs?
8,000.
So you should have 8,000 written down there somewhere. And then to find the stroke volume, you have to divide both sides by the heart rate. So it would be the 8,000 divided by the heart rate, which I said was
100.
So it's 80.
Yes. And your answer comes out to be 80 mLs. All right, so you understand how to change the formula to find the X? So just a couple things about the cardiac output. If the heart is failing and it's not ejecting much blood and the stroke volume is low, what do you think would be a way where you keep up with cardiac output even though the stroke volume is low?
Increase the time on therapy?
Yes, that would treat it, but I'm just looking at the formula for right now. So we know cardiac output is heart rate times stroke volume. If stroke volume is low, what can be done to, what can the body do to itself?
Increase the heart rate to increase cardiac output.
Yes. So that's how the body compensates for a low stroke volume, is it'll just increase how many times per minute it beats. It'll increase the heart rate. So a faster heart rate with a low stroke volume is still maintaining cardiac output. What do you think? You're in the Bahamas already.
It's getting late.
All right, so that's the application. Those are the critical thinking questions that you're going to be faced with concerning cardiac output. You know, the stroke volume is low. What can the heart do to keep up with cardiac output? All right, now let's talk about cardiac index. And cardiac index is probably a better number than looking at just cardiac output, because a football player who's 300 pounds, 6 feet 5, is an adult, and a tiny old 80-year-old lady who stands 4 feet 5 high is an adult. Are they both going to have the same cardiac output?
No.
No. So how do we know what's normal for each? Well, when you divide the cardiac output by the size of the body, and that's called body surface area, you're going to come up with cardiac output per body surface area, and that number is going to have more of a meaning for what's normal or what's considered okay. We don't need to treat that. Oh, that's bad. I think we need to use some drugs to improve it. So cardiac output divided by body surface area gives you cardiac index. And it doesn't matter what size you are, it should always be better. If you have a healthy heart and a good cardiac output, it should be better than 2.5 liters per minute. And then you're dividing by surface area, which is in square meters. So that's where the units come from. So 2.5 liters per minute per square meter. Cardiac output divided by body surface area. Liters per minute per square meter. So if the 300-pound football player, 6 feet 5, has a really high body surface area, but also has a high cardiac output, when you divide the two, it'll probably be above 2.5, 3.0 or a little bit above 2.5 is enough. And then the 80-year-old has a 3.5 liter cardiac output, but when you divide that by their body surface area, it's going to come out to be above 2.5. You know, 2.5 or maybe a little higher. All right, so you're going to do your body surface area on the chart that I gave you. Do you want body surface area chart? And you're going to need an extra piece of paper because you have to draw a line that's going to intersect all three columns on the graph. All right, so your height in feet is on the left. So find your height in feet and put a dot on that. You can get a body surface area chart. And then in the very right column, look for your weight in pounds and put a dot on that. And then use a piece of paper or a ruler or whatever you have, a straight edge, to connect the two dots. Isn't it? And wherever it intersects in that middle column is what your body surface area is.
You lie about our weight.
If it crosses in between two numbers, each one of those little tiny dashes are, I guess, 0.02. So if you're between 1.4 and 1.5, that first little dash would be 1.42, the second dash would be 1.44. Does that make sense? Does everybody have their body surface area? Mm-hmm. All right, what did you get, Judy?
1.54.
1.54? Okay, now let me pick. What did you get?
2.2.
2.2? What did you get, Zachary?
2.1.
What did you get, Sam? 2.2? What is the second number? Did you get 2.2 something? Or did it cross exactly on 2.2? So it should be like 2.22, 2.24. So you should have two numbers. And that's going to make a difference when you're dividing. So make sure you have two decimal two places to the right of the decimal when you come up with your body surface area.
So if it was right on, you put 2.0 or 2.20.
Yes. Okay. All right, now imagine your cardiac output. Not everybody's going to have the same cardiac output. Did you have a question?
I'm trying to determine what number the
it's between two?
You'll take up a high surface area. Just an itty bitty. Actually, you have 0.9. That's her body surface.
Good question. Yeah. Non-invasively by ultrasound. So ultrasound takes a picture of the ventricle when it's full, and then a picture of the ventricle when it's empty. Mm-hmm. And from the change in size, it can tell how much blood is ejected. Mm-hmm. So, good question. All right, so imagine your cardiac output is 6 liters a minute. What is your body surface area? Do you know how to do that? The cardiac output is 6 liters a minute. And I want to know what your cardiac index is. Would you be able to find it? So 6.0 divided by your body surface area, and you're going to come up with your cardiac index. Now, if you're really small, chances are your cardiac output is not 6 liters, so the number that you get might be less than 2.5, or don't panic, it's just probably not your cardiac output.
Yeah.
where they got 3.5.
To the tenths, so one decimal place.
Okay, great.
So you're finding your cardiac index by taking your cardiac output, which we don't know, so I just told you it was 6 liters. You're dividing by your body surface area and coming up with your cardiac index. All right, tell me some numbers.
3.5.
3.7.
4.4.
4.4, okay, tiny, that's why.
What else?
3.6? So greater than 2.5 is good. Less than 2.5, now we start wondering, do we need to give some cardiac meds to improve the cardiac output?
What if it's like 5.0? Is that really bad? Or is it good? No, that's not what I got, but just wondering.
Depending on the rest of the clinical picture, patients that have a massive infection in their body, they're septic. One of the symptoms they have is a high output, high cardiac output, high cardiac index. So you can't just look at one number and make a decision. I'm sure it's a...
So the unit would be liters per minute. Liters per...
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, is that... Liters per minute.
Yeah, liters per minute per square meter. Liters per minute per square meter. So the liters per minute was the cardiac output part, and then the per square meter was the body surface area. And then we have ejection fraction. This is an important number that you hear used probably at the bedside of most of your ICU patients. And what it is the percentage of blood that's ejected from the ventricle when it contracts. And I can say things slower and give you a chance to write notes, but just to give you an overall idea of what ejection fraction is. So it's the percentage of blood ejected from the ventricle. And if the heart is healthy, then normally it ejects, what does it say here, 65%? I think in your textbook there's a range, 55 to 65. So that's considered normal. Heart's working great, it's ejecting 60% of the blood in the ventricle when it contracts, everything looks great. Then as that number falls, now it's an indication that the heart is failing, it's not doing as well. That's the importance of ejection fraction. The other importance of ejection fraction is when the heart can't eject blood very well, the blood tends to back up in the system. So it backs up into the pulmonary veins, it backs up into the capillaries in the lungs, it backs up into the pulmonary artery. Now there's a lot of pressure, and all that pressure, and I'm going to repeat this again in another lecture, all that pressure in those vessels cause leakage of fluid, and fluid goes into the interstitial space, and now it's really hard for the person to breathe. So that's the connection between a low ejection fraction and respiratory, is your patient has heart failure and they're short of breath. Why? Well, it's because the heart isn't ejecting it, it's all backing up into the lungs, is you know how you would explain it to the families. All right, so it says here the percentage of blood ejected from the ventricle during systole. It tells you normal ejection fraction is 65%, and the range would be 55 to 65. And to find what the ejection fraction is, it's the stroke volume. So that's the blood that's ejected. Do you have to write that? I think so. Yeah, you have to add notes to it. So SV, stroke volume. EDV is end diastolic volume. EDV is end diastolic volume. And end diastolic volume is When the heart is full of blood right before it contracts, do you want to write it down exactly like that, or does that already make sense to you? So during diastole, the ventricle fills. And when the most amount of blood is in the ventricle right before it contracts, that volume is called the end diastolic volume. So that's when the ventricle is the most full, or the fullest. So I can repeat what I told you initially. The heart is full of blood right before it contracts. The heart is full of blood right before it contracts. And diastolic volume.
And basically, it's like a preload when you put at the end diastolic, you now have a sense with the preload?
Yes. Yeah, so you could call that the preload also.
Because always confusing when you try to think about this one and that preload and the preload. So it's basically a preload and then you contract. I can say.
And then after it contracts what?
I can say basically when the heart is contract.
So the preload or the volume when it's full.
Yeah, when it's full.
And then it contracts, and what is the volume left in the ventricle after it contracts?
So there's a left of blood in the ventricle. A left of blood in the ventricle, right? When the blood is like basically when the heart is contract, right?
There's still blood left in the ventricle after it contracts. Is that what you're asking?
Blood left in the ventricle is basically how they call it a preload.
No, it would be the volume before it contracts.
It's the same information.
So the EBV is the preload?
Yeah.
Before it contracts.
Mm-hmm.
The heart is full of blood right after contraction. So it's the same information. Yeah. It's the same definition.
Mm-hmm. And then for low ejection fraction, it's less than 50%. A low ejection fraction is less than 50%. And then write this question down. What happens to quality of life? What happens to quality of life? Or activities of daily living. Or activities of daily living. If a patient has an ejection fraction less than 50%. Ejection fraction is less than 50%. How does that affect activities of daily living? That's one thing that's looked at when patients are in the hospital, and if they're going to be discharged home, can they go home? Can they walk to the bathroom? Can they feed themselves? How well will they function if they've had a heart attack and now their heart is not functioning very well? The ejection fraction is less than 50%. The connecting information would be a low ejection fraction, harder to breathe. So they might struggle walking up steps, they might struggle just going to the bathroom and back. So the connection is it becomes hard to breathe when the ejection fraction is low.
It's because they have all the backflow, back pressure.
Yes. Yeah, when there's fluid in the interstitial spaces of the lungs, it makes the lungs stiffer and harder. It takes more work to be able to breathe in that circumstance. And then how is ejection fraction measured? It's measured with echocardiogram, or it's called cardiac ultrasound. Measured with echocardiogram. Do you know how to spell that?
Mm-hmm.
Echocardiogram. Or
echo?
Yes. echo, ECHO, echocardiogram, or it's called cardiac ultrasound. And this is when the ultrasound takes a picture of the ventricle when it's full, measures it, and then it takes a picture of the ventricle after it has contracted, measures it, and then the difference in size, it can calculate volume that left the ventricle, the volume of blood that left the ventricle. Questions on that? Okay, so that ends our anatomy and physiology of the heart. There's practice questions posted in E2L, and you're going to want to practice because those are the easy points on the exam. If you're given a formula, not a lot of critical thinking and just filling in the numbers for the formula. So make sure you're really good with the formulas, you can plug numbers in, and those are going to be the easy points on the test. Alright, your next handout is pulmonary blood flow. Talk about pulmonary blood flow. It says this lecture is sponsored by, and then it talks about, no, it doesn't must be. Do you guys have it on yours?
James Clayton?
Yes. Okay, so let me read that. A 77-year-old patient with COPD was in congestive heart failure upon arrival in the emergency department. After 4 hours of IV meds, oxygen, BiPAP, and breathing treatments, the patient was greatly improved. And when you're learning your beginning anatomy and physiology, we're kind of away from the bedside and talking about theory and you're thinking, oh, what does this have to do with anything? So that's why I kind of bring in a picture of a patient and talk about that, just to keep you connected. So a patient with congestive heart failure, can you imagine that they're going to be short of breath, that their heart isn't pumping effectively? And this person has COPD, that's a lung disease. So already they're short of breath, and now being short of breath for many years, it puts a strain on the heart. The heart has to work a lot harder, and then the heart goes into failure. So that just complicates the difficulty breathing. So this patient's really short of breath. But it can be treated up until their end stage. Pardon me. So they're given IV meds to get the heart to pump more strong. They get rid of excess fluid. Oxygen is given. BiPAP, have you heard of that? No. It's there's a machine that you'll become very familiar with, and you put a mask on the patient's face, but because positive pressure is going to be delivered, you have to strap the mask on the face, not tight, but tight enough to be able to get the positive pressure to go. And when they breathe in, the high flow of air pushes the air into their lungs and makes it easier for them to breathe. So this patient, Mr. Clayton, says, I couldn't breathe. I thought I was going to die. My lungs are bad from so many years of smoking. My respiratory therapist was there to comfort me every step of the way. He told me to wear a mask, and I remember telling him to go to hell. Can you imagine being really short of breath and somebody tells you, well, if you strap this on your face, it's going to help you? So, you know, it's claustrophobic almost. So when you're short of breath, putting a mask on. So I guess he was fighting with the therapist. He stayed patient with me, but let me tell you, boy, do those needle sticks hurt. So patients that are in respiratory distress, an arterial blood gas will be ordered on them. And the arterial blood can tell if they're still breathing effectively enough, or do we have to intubate them and put them on a ventilator to help them breathe. So patients in respiratory distress, you need to draw arterial blood. And the problem with drawing arterial blood is there's a nerve right next to the artery, And you can't tell if it's running on top of it, to the side of it. So when you put the needle in, sometimes you hit that nerve, and the patients remember that awful, painful feeling. So a radial stick is not popular with the patients, that's for sure.
What's the difference between giving O2 and the bypass?
With O2, just giving a nasal cannula or an on-rig breather mask, there's no positive pressure. But with the BiPAP, there is positive pressure, and that improves oxygenation.
So you're giving both?
Yeah, and for the mask, you can select the concentration of oxygen that you want. All right, we'll go to about 10:30, and then I'll give you a break. So we're talking about pulmonary circulation. Pulmonary circulation begins with the pulmonic valve and ends at the point where the pulmonary veins enter the left atrium. So all those vessels are considered pulmonary circulation. And it says the primary function is to get blood to and from the lung so oxygen can enter the capillaries and carbon dioxide or waste products can leave the blood and enter the alveoli. Which of the following describes the pulmonary artery? A, it contains oxygenated blood, or B, it contains deoxygenated blood?
B, deoxygenated.
B, so circle B. So if it contains deoxygenated blood, why are we calling it the pulmonary artery?
Away from the heart.
Yes, so any vessel going away from the heart is an artery, whether the blood is oxygenated or deoxygenated. Locate the pulmonary arteries and the pulmonary veins. This picture is interesting because it shows the outside of the heart, but it's kind of see-through. So you can see inside the right ventricle. And here's the left ventricle. So the pulmonary arteries is on the right. So this would be the... It's called pulmonary trunk when you're looking at anatomy. It's called the pulmonary artery when you're at the hospital. It divides into the right pulmonary artery, the left pulmonary artery. So you've got one artery going to each lung, left and right lung. And then the vessels, of course, go from large vessels and then they get smaller and they branch and then they get really tiny and become capillaries. And that's when they pass by the alveoli, the gas exchange occurs, but then the blood is going to travel back to the left heart, and what do we call that? Pulmonary veins. So in this picture, we only see the left side, the pulmonary veins. And on your handout, it's really tiny, isn't it? What do the pulmonary veins empty into?
The left atrium.
The left atrium. So we've got the oxygenated blood coming back to the left atrium. Here's another picture of pulmonary circulation. So it's colored blue, where we've got the deoxygenated blood coming back to the right heart. What vein is this called up here?
Superior
vena cava. What about this one down here?
Superior.
Right. And then they come together, and the blood enters the right atrium. And then the right ventricle kicks it into the pulmonary circulation. So you see it going to the left, see it going to the right. Exchanging gases and then returning. And when it returns, it comes into the left atrium and then it gets ejected out into the left atrium.
So it's not considered pulmonary circulation until it passes that pulmonary valve, right?
Yes, depending which book you read. Oh, you already read it?
Yeah.
It's different in another book?
Yeah. It'd be right ventricle, so I was like, I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, so I have right ventricle, and Michi has pulmonic valve.
Mm-hmm.
I have pulmonic valve. So I agree with Michi. So maybe it's different than Egan. Which one did you find it? Starting with the right ventricle.
I can't remember which one. If you say pulmonary valve, we're good with that.
Okay. Pulmonic valve it is.
Okay.
Alright, so looking at the pressures, I know the next slide talks about pressures. Probably end up coming back to this picture. But when the right ventricle is ejecting blood into the pulmonary arteries, look at the pressure. 24 over 9. So if you could get a little blood pressure cuff and wrap it around the pulmonary artery and take the blood pressure in the pulmonary artery, you would find out that it's 24 over 9. So how does that compare to arterial circulation? Arterial 120 over 80 millimeters mercury is a normal blood pressure.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot lower in the pulmonary vessels, a lot lower.
Is it due in part to the contraction of the ventricle, of the left ventricle pushing the force, pushing the blood out?
The resistance is less in the pulmonary vessels because there's a lot of branching that occurs. There's less smooth muscle around the vessels, so they're a little more distended. Those two reasons.
So we need to know the transitioning numbers, or just know that it goes from 120 over 80 to 10 millimeters in the capillaries?
There are numbers that you need to know, and I'm going to tell them to you, so don't focus on them yet, but in a few minutes. All right, so a low resistance circuit, we pointed out that the pressures are low, and when we plug it into the equation to find out what pulmonary vascular resistance is, do you notice the equation looks exactly like when we were calculating systemic vascular resistance? So it's the beginning pressure minus the ending pressure. You divide by the cardiac output, and then multiply by 80 to put it into units of resistance. And then it explains everything in the equation. MPAP is the mean pulmonary artery pressure. Do you know how you would calculate the mean pulmonary artery pressure if all you had was the systolic and diastolic?
Yeah, two times.
Two times.
Divided by three, but you gotta time it by
two.
Well, before you even put it into this equation, you have to do all that stuff.
Yeah.
So mean pulmonary artery pressure was just like mean arterial pressure.
Right.
So systole, twice diastole over three.
Mm-hmm.
Sure?
Yeah.
You guys will be able to do that? Marie, what do you think?
Systole plus twice diastole divided by three.
All right, so we have a pulmonary artery pressure of 24 over 9. What is the mean pulmonary artery pressure? So it would be systolic plus two times diastolic and divide by three. So 24 plus two times nine.
Well, is it number 24 over what?
24 over nine.
Okay.
24 over nine. What is the mean pulmonary artery pressure? 24 is 2 times 9, and then you divide by 3, and what did you get?
19.
I got 14. So it's 42 on the top, divide by 3. 14?
Yes.
So that would be the mean pulmonary artery pressure. That's what you would have to do in order to use this formula.
Okay.
because that's going to give you your average starting pressure. Okay, so MPAP, subtract the left atrial pressure, and that would have to be given to you. This is the pressure in the left atrium, and then you would just plug it into the formula. So you would have your beginning pressure, the ending pressure over on the left side, subtract those, divide by the cardiac output, and then you multiply by 80 to turn it into units of resistance. The normal pulmonary vascular resistance is 100 to 250, and then here's those units of resistance. The disc, dynes, per second, per centimeter to the minus 5. How does that compare to systemic vascular resistance? Do you remember the normal from last week?
900 to something.
Yeah, 900 to 1400 versus 100. So you can see the difference in resistance. So that last question asks you, why is this so much lower than systemic vascular resistance? And I have the answer. First thing, the pulmonary vessels are very distensible, very stretchy. So the pulmonary vessels are very distensible.
Stretchy.
Yes, stretchy. They can hold a lot of blood volume without the pressures increasing. They can hold a lot of blood volume without pressures increasing. Did you get that?
Mm-hmm.
So they can hold a lot of blood volume without pressures increasing. Another reason, another bullet, there's very little smooth muscle. Compared to systemic arteries and arterioles. So very little smooth muscle compared to systemic arteries and arterioles. And one more. It has a very large capillary bed. A very large capillary bed.
That's where pulmonary circulation is very large.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is explaining why it has such a low resistance in the pulmonary circulation. The right and left ventricle outputs must be equal. Why? Didn't we talk about that already? So if we talked about it already, maybe you could explain it? Does anybody want to explain that to
me?
Right, so what comes in has to go out. Otherwise you're going to get unequal.
Lopsided pump.
Lopsided pump, you're right. Another practice problem for figuring out pulmonary vascular resistance. I'll let you do that on your own because we didn't already. No, we didn't. All we did was pulmonary artery pressure. All right, so let's do this. Calculate the pulmonary vascular resistance with the following values. It tells you the mean pulmonary artery pressure is 16 millimeters of mercury, and the pressure in the left atrium, 8 millimeters of mercury. What is the pulmonary vascular resistance? Can you plug it into the formula? Mm-hmm. Is that 120?
128.
128?
Yeah.
Times 2. Did everybody get the same answer? Because I don't know what the answer is.
Yes.
So 128?
Yes.
Is that considered normal pulmonary vascularization?
Yes. What is the unit for that? The dimes
per second.
Yes. I remember the word desk, and that helps me. Dimes per second, per centimeter to the minus 5.
Do we have to write that one time?
The units? Yes. Yeah, really important for units.
What is it?
Yeah, the units for resistance, dimes per second, per centimeter to the minus 5.
So we have to write 128 dimes.
Alright, so we'll take a 15-minute break. Julie, can you hit the stop on the camera? To measure pressure in the pulmonary artery, a Swan-Ganz catheter can do that job. And the catheter has to be inserted into the pulmonary artery. So the best way to get to it is through the subclavian vein, which drains into the right atrium. In the right atrium, the catheter will go into the right ventricle, and then it'll go through the pulmonic valve and into the pulmonary artery, and when it's there, it measures pressures. So that's how we can get pulmonary artery pressures. It's a Swan-Ganz catheter.
We won't be doing that, will we?
No.
Oh.
But you're going to see it in your patient.
Okay.
So when you go in to do an assessment and you see this yellow catheter hanging out of their shoulder, you're going to say, oh, it's a Swan-Ganz catheter. And then you're going to see pulmonary artery pressures on the monitor, and then you'll be able to put the two and two together.
So do we need to know how the roots, how to insert and all that for the test? Or?
Yes. And it's in your notes, and we're going to get to it in a second. When it's inserted, it's possible that the lung can be punctured, so that's why I tell you about where it's inserted. A chest x-ray is obtained after insertion of the catheter to make sure there isn't a pneumothorax. So that's the connection to respiratory. Not that you'll be inserting it, but you just have to know what the hazards are, and what it's measuring, the purposes. It takes a minute to come up. So the company that puts out the Swan-Ganz catheter, what was that?
I guess I got confused. We heard you say that we didn't have to know it. So do we have to know that, or we don't have to know
it? We don't have to worry that we're not the ones that do it.
That do it, but we have to know it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh
my God, I
know
I'm going to say that. Alright, so the company that makes the catheter is Edwards, and on their website they have this video. So it shows the catheter being inserted, which is pretty neat. The catheter has a balloon on it, and when the balloon is inflated, it just helps the blood to push the catheter through the different chambers of the heart and then help it to sit in the pulmonary artery correctly. So it's in the right atrium, pressures are low. Crosses over the tricuspid valve, gets into the ventricle, and then notice that pressures are higher. So when the ventricle contracts, pressures go up, fills, contracts, it fills. Now it's going past the pulmonic valve. Now it's in the pulmonary artery, but it looks like it's going to go left. And now that you have a vessel, there's a diastolic pressure. So systolic, diastolic. And then it goes, or it gets pushed into a wedged position. And then that's where the catheter stays. But of course, the balloon cannot stay inflated because then there would be no blood flow getting past that. And within 4 minutes, you have tissue death. So the balloon is only inflated temporarily. When it's inflated and it's wedged, it's a reflection of the left heart, actually. Even though you've got the lung, you've got the pulmonary arteries, the capillaries, and it goes back to the pulmonary veins. When it's wedged, it actually is a reflection of the pressures in the left heart.
So
it's all one circuit.
Does the balloon go on its own or someone?
Nursing is in charge of the Swan-Ganz catheters in South Florida. In the Orlando area, then No, respiratory does the calibration at the bedside. It has to be calibrated every shift. So different responsibilities depending on where you live. So down here it's nursing, and we're going to go through all these different ports and where they end up. But at the very tip, there's a balloon.
Oh, wow. That's pretty big.
So this is, when you're inflating it, just use, what is it set at? I think it's set at 1 cc of air. All the other ones that I've passed around have popped from them being overinflated. So try to use, it's set at 1 cc. So don't use more than 1 cc to inflate it. I'll start one on one end.
I mean, that goes through the heart and stuff. Doesn't the cord get interrupted with the bowels and stuff?
Yeah, you would think it would tear the valves and interrupt the valves, and it doesn't.
It doesn't?
Sometimes when it touches the wall of the vessel, it can cause an arrhythmia to occur, but then it subsides.
But then the valves can't close, right?
Yeah, it seems like the valves...
Right, it seems like the catheter is going to keep the valve open a little bit, right. And there's going to be a little bit of a leak.
Right.
But that's not the concern, yeah.
Wow. So when you put it in, like, you don't have to wait for the valve to open, you can just close the valve.
Yes. Well, no. When the valve is closed, it won't flow through.
So you wait for it.
All you do is push the catheter into the side of the balloon, inflate the balloon, and then the blood flow does the rest. The blood flow carries it into the blood flow carries. Good questions.
Is that video of V2L? It's on our PowerPoint, right?
Mm-hmm. Pictures. Okay. Yeah, it's all here. Yeah, it's on a couple pages coming up. So, to be familiar with pressures and what pressures are normal and when they're elevated, what does that mean? You have to know what the normal pressures are. Yes, you have to know these. In the right atrium, when the catheter is in the right atrium, it's going to see pressures between 2 and 6 millimeters mercury. Does that sound familiar? Mm-hmm. We talked about it last week. What's another name for right atrial pressure?
Central venous pressure?
CVP? Yeah, CVP or central venous pressure. Then when the tip is in the right ventricle, it measures the pressure. 20 to 30 when the ventricle contracts, 0 to 5 when the ventricle is relaxed and filling with blood. Then the catheter moves into the pulmonary artery, and then we get readings of 20 to 30 for the systolic pressure, 6 to 15 millimeters mercury for the diastolic pressure. So do you notice when there's a vessel, you've got a higher diastolic pressure than you do when you're in a chamber with the ventricle? All right, so a way to remember pulmonary artery pressures. I remember 2 dozen over 1 dozen, and that helps me. Do you know that a dozen is 12? Okay. So 24 over 12. If you remember 24 over 12 being a normal pulmonary artery pressure, that helps. Or if you can remember the range, that's good too. 20 to 30 systolic, 6 to 15 diastolic. Then the catheter is allowed to wedge, so the balloon is inflated, and the catheter is carried until it can't go any further, and that's considered the wedge position. And then there's another pressure reading taken. So the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is between 4 and 12 millimeters of mercury. One dozen? I'm trying to think of a way to help you remember things. So 4 to 12 for the wedge pressure. All right, and then to write some notes about the different parts of the Sonnemann's catheter. When you take your national exam, they won't say Swan-Ganz catheter. They will say a balloon tip flow-directed catheter. So that's why I put the name on there. Or a flow-directed balloon tip catheter. That's how they describe a Swan-Ganz catheter. I guess they try to shy away from using brand names. So for the proximal port, this has an opening. It measures pressures proximal to the right ventricle, so that would be right atrium. It's before the right ventricle, and then in parentheses, just put right atrium. The proximal port opens before the right ventricle, or of course the right atrium is before the right ventricle. So in parentheses, put right atrium. So if it's talking about port, do you know what port means? Port?
Entry site.
Entry site? An opening?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So fluids can be injected into the proximal port, and when they are, they end up in the right atrium. The distal port is after the right ventricle. Which is the pulmonary artery. So, proximal distal. It's using the right ventricle as its base. Before the right ventricle, we would say the proximal port. After the right ventricle, we would say distal port. Next is the thermistor. This measures the temperature of the blood. So you get core temperature, meaning core temperature.
You call it core temperature?
Mm-hmm.
That's the temperature of the blood?
Yes. So when temperature is taken in the body, when it's taken in the armpit or the ear, rectal temperatures are done in the ICU. All of those temperatures are not considered core temperature, but measuring the blood temperature in the very, the pulmonary arteries is called the core temperature, and the most accurate way to measure temperature. Alright, and then it says there's a balloon, and this is used to the balloon is used to momentarily occlude blood flow in the pulmonary artery. So the balloon is used to momentarily occlude blood flow in the pulmonary artery. So the catheter that's going around, who has it? Well, hang on to it because I'm going to ask you to find something. You have both of them? Oh, okay. So the ladies that are holding the Swan Dance catheter, I want you to look on the catheter for the blue colored port. Or you'll see like the part where you can add a IV tubing to it or a syringe to it. And it's blue. What does it say on that blue part? Does it have little tiny letters?
It says prox and inject.
Right, so prox or proximal, and that's where you could inject fluid, IV fluids. All right, look for the yellow one. It should be a dark yellow. And what does it say on it?
Distal.
Distal. All right, so if you inject IV fluids into that, it's going to come out at the very end of the catheter. Okay. But if you inject any fluids into the proximal port, it comes out probably in the right atrium. Right atrium. Okay, do you notice anything else on here? The thermistor? Can you find the thermistor on the one that you're holding? Can you hold it up so they can see the red cap? All right, so that's a thermistor. So you would connect something that measures temperature. It's usually part of a monitor that sits at the patient's bedside. And everybody got to try and inflate the balloon? Mm-hmm. Were you guys able to inflate the balloon on yours?
No.
It was blown, right?
We haven't gotten it.
Oh, you haven't gotten it yet? Do you want to pass? One of them works. So this one does. So that's the balloon inflation. And is it good to leave the balloon inflated all the time?
No.
Why would it happen?
No.
It would include both.
So the thermistor is like, takes the temperature, mm-hmm. and the result is the core temperature.
Yes. All right, so this is the website that I just showed you. When the swan gas catheter is inserted, this picture shows how it's done. So you'll see a syringe with a really long needle on it. And the usually the intensivist in charge of the patient will insert the catheter. So they have to go under the clavicle and head towards the midline. And that's where the subclavian vein is coming into the right atrium. And again, if they, even if they have perfect technique, there's a 2-3% chance that it's going to nick the lung. And just like a small needle prick into the lung will deflate the lung. Air will start leaking and going around the lung into the pleural space. And all that air just accumulates because once it gets there, it can't go anywhere. So you keep getting air building up around the lung, building up around the lung, and it just compresses the lung. The patient's going to get shorter breath. Eventually, it can actually stop blood flow to the heart, so it needs to be treated. So after insertion, there's always a chest X-ray. Sometimes they'll tell you, well, turn the people. You don't have to. So 2-3% possibility of puncturing the lung during insertion. Did you write that down?
Mm-hmm.
2-3% possibility of puncturing the lung. This is called a pneumothorax. And then write one more note about it. The catheter is usually kept in the patient 2 days or less due to risk of infection. So having an opening in the skin, even if they use sterile technique, they betadine the skin, they put neosporin over it, go through all of that, and still an infection can get into the body. So that's why they don't like to keep it in for a long period of time. So the sentence that I told you, usually kept in the patient 2 days or less, 2 days or less, due to risk of infection. All right, when the balloon is inflated and wedges itself in a pulmonary artery, a pressure reading is obtained. What does that pressure reading reflect? I'll tell you the notes to write because we're going to discuss this in detail. The pressure, it reflects the pressure in the left heart.
In right heart?
Left. Oops. Left heart. It reflects the pressure in the left heart. So this pressure can be called the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So you can write in your notes the PCWP. And then if you want to write after what it stands for.
Is that pulmonary?
Keep going.
PC what?
PCWP.
Pulmonary capillary wedge pressure.
Yes, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure.
Okay.
And since it's reflecting the pressure in the left heart, it can also be called, so write the abbreviation first, LVEDP for left ventricular end diastolic pressure, LVEDP, and that's left ventricular end diastolic pressure. Left ventricular end diastolic pressure.
That's another name for the pressure?
Yes.
What was the PCW?
Pulmonary capillary draft pressure.
So PCWP, aka LVEDP.
It doesn't get better than that. The normal is 4 to 12 millimeters of mercury. So left ventricular end diastolic pressure. Here's a picture. Let's see if this makes sense. So we're over on the right side of the heart. We've got this one gas catheter. It's sitting in a pulmonary artery. The balloon is inflated. It's allowed to wedge into position. Once it gets wedged into position, it's reflecting all of the pressures in front of it, all the way to the left heart. Now, when the left heart is filling, you notice the mitral valve is open. So that is why we can say that the pressure we get from the balloon, including the vessel, is a reflection of the left ventricular end diastolic pressure, is because there's really nothing in the way to stop it. So that's why it reflects the left ventricle. So we can sit in the pulmonary artery and find out what's going on over on the left heart. Got that? Mm-hmm. Very good.
So
because that's a hard concept to kind of grasp.
So the balloon stays inflated in the blood. The blood movement is what wedges it and takes it out and then wedges it?
No. Inflate the balloon, let it wedge, get your reading, and then immediately deflate the balloon.
And then you take out immediately?
Yes.
Oh, so yeah. Why
for a few seconds do you leave it inflated?
So, well, you leave the catheter in, right? Mm-hmm. So you just leave it not inflated?
Correct.
So when you need a reading, that's when you go inflate it?
Yes.
So let me get this in. Getting the reading from the opposite ventricle. In your okay.
Yep.
Okay. So about the pressure. You say inside and you feel it.
Yes.
Do you always do you always read the left ventricle or do you also read the right ventricle?
You can read the right ventricle too.
And then the other way.
So hooking up the proximal port to a pressure transducer, now you can get a reading of the right ventricle. The catheter is sitting in the pulmonary artery, so you're getting a continuous readout of those pressures. And so the bottom line is, a lot of diagnosing can be done with these values, and that's the reason for explaining it to you. Like, how do you know a patient is in heart failure? How do you know that maybe they're just hypovolemic? So all of these pressure readings are obtained, and then a decision is made as far as what needs to be done to the patient. And for the Swan-Ganz readings, we already talked about normals, but you can write them down again. CVP, 2 to 6 millimeters mercury. PA systolic, does anybody remember it? 2001 dozen. So systolic, you could write the 20 to 30 millimeters mercury for the range, or like an average of 24. The PA diastolic, 6 to 15. What are the units? Yes, millimeters mercury. Pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, 4 to 12. Good.
This is all millimeters of mercury?
Yes. Body temperature? What is normal?
78.
98.
Oh. We're talking about just overall body temperature.
Core body temperature.
37 Celsius. Right?
Yes, 37 degrees Celsius. All right, a swan dance catheter can calculate cardiac output. One way is by putting cold solution before the heart and then taking a measurement after the right ventricle. And from that, the computer calculates the cardiac output. So let me have you write that down. It's called thermodilution cardiac output. Thermodilution, T-H-E-R-M-O, thermodilution, cardiac output. There's like three bullets to write to understand it.
What is
it? I hope you have room. So thermodilution, cardiac output. Write down that a cold solution, cold, like colder than body temperature, probably room temperature, is injected into the proximal port of the catheter. So cold solution is injected into the proximal port of the catheter. Did you get that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Second, the dilution of the blood will change the temperature. Dilution of the blood will change the temperature. And third, the thermistor will measure the temperature change and calculate the cardiac output. The thermistor will measure the temperature change and will calculate the cardiac output.
Is it one more time? Sorry.
No, that's okay. The thermistor will measure the temperature change and will calculate the cardiac output. So does the thermodilution make sense? Thermo refers to temperature, dilution. You're diluting the blood to see what the temperature change will be. And from that, you calculate the cardiac output. And I don't, not you, but the computer does it. And then they have fancier ones nowadays where you don't have to inject any solution at all. It knows what the cardiac output is. I have no idea, but it can figure it out.
I have a question.
Sure.
We did PA systolic, it was like 20 to 30 millimeters of mercury, and then the PA diastolic, which was a 6 to 15. So you pulled those from this picture, correct? So how do you know that which PA you were? Like if you pulled the systolic from this one, from the right ventricle, and the diastolic from the artery.
It's not
20
to
30?
I don't know.
It's for the PA systolic. Like you said, systolic was 20 to 30. And then the next bullet says PA diastolic, and we said 6 to 15, which is that one.
Yeah, this is pulmonary artery. Are you wondering why I didn't take these numbers?
Yeah. Oh, never mind. I thought you pulled that 20 to 30. But it's the same. I didn't realize it was the same.
Oh, I see.
I was like, hey, what?
Okay, so interpretation of pulmonary artery pressure readings. Do you guys want to keep on going or do you want a quick break?
No,
can we keep on going? And there's five more pages. All right, well, we'll keep going for a few minutes. When I see your heads drooping, then we might take a break. So interpreting pulmonary artery pressure readings. All right, hypervolemia, first you have to write a description of what it is, and then we'll talk about how that would change the pulmonary artery pressure readings. Did I give you a description of this already? So it's at above normal blood in the vascular space. Above normal blood in the vascular space. It's missing the word volume.
Yeah.
Okay, above normal blood volume in the vascular space. And then write down increases BP. And also write this down, it increases workload on a failing heart. Increases workload for a failing heart. And then write down an example, which would be renal failure. Example would be renal failure. So can you imagine the kidneys not being able to make urine and all of the fluid? So you take a drink of water and the fluid stays in your blood vessels. You take another drink of water, the fluid stays in your blood vessels because you can't pee it out. So that would be an example of hypervolemia. There isn't enough urine output to get rid of excess fluid, so it stays in the vascular spaces and increases the volume in the blood vessels. So that's hypervolemia. And then it asks, how are pulmonary artery pressures and pulmonary capillary wedge pressures influenced by this? You can write down, every pressure is elevated. Every pressure is elevated. So what would happen to pulmonary artery pressures? It would go up. So you could put arrow up, PAP. What would happen to the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure? It would go up. So put arrow up, PCWP. All the pressures would be elevated. All right, next you have hypovolemia. And you can write that as lower than normal blood volume. Lower than normal blood volume. And then for examples, dehydration and blood loss. Hypovolemia. How are pulmonary artery pressures and pulmonary capillary wedge pressures influenced by low blood volume?
Decreased.
All pressures will be decreased. So put arrow down, PAP. And then put arrow down, PCWP. Pulmonary vasoconstriction is pretty much what the word says. So hypoxia is low oxygen in the tissues. So low amount of oxygen causes the pulmonary vessels to constrict. Low oxygen causes pulmonary vessels to constrict. The pulmonary vessels. Do you see how you have a blank space that you got to fill in? See, I know that you guys are sleeping because nobody asked me why the pulmonary vessels constrict if the oxygen level is low. That's a sign?
I think I want to know.
You know what? How does it help the body?
Oh, how does it help?
Yeah.
How do I know?
You don't know that?
No.
The heart is starting to conflict state where it's slowing, I wouldn't say slowing everything down.
Would it increase the pressure?
Does it slow it down?
No.
It would increase the pressure, right?
Constriction will increase pressure. So if you ever had a hose and you put your thumb over the end of a hose to cover half of the opening, and then the water shoots out a lot further and a lot faster. So I guess constricting the pulmonary vessels does the same thing as your thumb over the hose, where it causes the blood to shoot through faster. Just thinking of it as squeezing the blood and pushing it to the lungs quicker. So hey, Matt, we need to get some oxygen in this blood. Get it to the lungs quick. Yes, it's a defense mechanism. So that's the response. And then there's, does it mention the pH also?
Next one.
Oh, okay. So I thought there
were. We have what will happen to the pulmonary vessels.
So, you have this?
Yeah.
Okay, mine was different. So what will happen to pulmonary vessels in response to low oxygen levels and an acidic pH in the blood? So what you don't know is that acidosis also constricts pulmonary blood vessels. Acidosis constricts pulmonary blood vessels. So imagine with acidotic pH constricting the vessels and hypoxia constricting the vessels, you have even a more, I'm missing a word. It's like an additive effect, I guess is the word. So it's asking you what will happen if both things are present, low oxygen and acidotic pH. Would have an additive effect in constricting the pulmonary vessels. Should we all parade over next door and start singing with them?
I have food.
Oh,
they
have food.
It's an additive. Can you repeat that?
Yeah, the two together have an additive effect in creating vasoconstriction.
The two meaning low oxygen and acidic pH.
The hypoxia, the low oxygen, and the acidotic pH would be the two. Together, create even more vasoconstriction.
So additive.
So they have, the two of them together have an additive effect in causing vasoconstriction. Now it's asking you what happens to pulmonary artery pressures if the vessels are constricted. Then the pressures go up. The question, what happens to pulmonary artery pressures if the vessels are constricted? Restrict the vessels. When you're measuring inside and you squeeze, now you're going to have higher pressures inside the vessel.
So you mean it's going to be a higher pressure with less oxygen?
Yes. Perfect.
Say that again, higher pressure?
Yeah, so if there's less oxygen in the body and the pulmonary vessels constrict, now you're going to have higher pressure inside the pulmonary vessels. Would the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure be elevated if the pulmonary vessels are constricted? So this takes a little bit of thinking. If you constrict the pulmonary vessels, are you really doing anything to the left ventricle? No. So, do you know how to answer the question if you keep that in mind? Would pulmonary capillary wedge pressure be elevated if the pulmonary vessels are constricted? everybody afraid to say no?
It was no because it's so far away from when you're applying the pressure.
Exactly. You're applying the pressure here in the pulmonary vessels, not over there in the left heart. So the wedge pressure would not be affected. No, it will not be.
Okay, why are you saying? What's the reason?
What's the reason that the left, what's the reason the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure doesn't go up? It's a reflection of the left ventricle, and the left ventricle isn't being affected by pulmonary arteries being constricted.
But it's not to affect the capillary wedge.
It's the pulmonary arterioles that have the sphincters and the smooth muscle that contract. That is not over in the left side of the heart. So the venules, the veins, the left atrium, left ventricle, all of that still has normal pressure. So can you imagine driving down I-95, and I-95 is your pulmonary artery. So all the cars driving down I-95 is your blood flow. And a semi tractor trailer starts swerving and overturns and blocks all the lanes right in front of you. Cars can't get past, so the blood can't get past. And all the blood ends up backing up because we have a blockage or a constriction of it. On the other side of the truck, down I-95, are there any problems with the flow of traffic? No. So maybe that can give you a picture in your mind when you're thinking of constricted pulmonary vessels, but yet the left heart's doing fine. So the constricted pulmonary vessels would be like that semi tractor trailer blocking the lanes. But yet the flow after that is fine. So when you get around that truck, you get around that truck, you know, you're free to flow.
It's actually really good thing, huh?
It is. Are you guys okay?
Mm-hmm.
You're not gonna scream uncle yet? Mm-hmm. It's good to go through this now, and then when we meet for the review session, or if you have questions, there's plenty of time to ask questions about it. Let's go for it. All right, with left heart failure, it gives you a little bit of an explanation. It says, coronary artery disease may reduce blood flow to the left ventricular muscle. So do you have a picture in your mind? You see the left ventricle with the LAD and the circumflex giving you some blood flow. Well, let's say those vessels aren't open anymore. They're all gunked up with plaque and you don't have good blood flow. So that left ventricular muscle no longer works as well. This causes a loss of pumping action of the muscle. So that left ventricle doesn't squeeze as well when it ejects blood. It says heart failure occurs. Blood backs up in the left atrium and into the pulmonary circulation. This increases the capillary pressures. So imagine that your left heart's not doing a good job. Blood flow is going to back up into the pulmonary veins, the pulmonary capillaries, and be reflected even back up in the pulmonary arteries. How does left heart failure affect pressures in the pulmonary artery? What happens to the PAP if you have heart failure? So imagine that the overturned truck is the left ventricle. What happens to everything behind the truck? The flow of traffic behind the truck. Everything gets backed up. A lot of cars, a lot of pressure. All right, so What happens to pressures in the pulmonary artery with left heart failure?
Increase.
It's increased. So put arrow up, PAP. The next question. How does left heart failure affect the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure reading from the Swan-Ganz catheter? So we allow the balloon to inflate, it gets occluded or wedged. And now it's reflecting pressure in the left heart. Do you think that would be a normal reading between 4 and 12? Mm-hmm. No. Do you think it would be higher than that?
Yeah.
Yes. So left heart failure, blood's not going to flow through the heart, it's going to back up, and now you're going to have elevated pressures. So increase, arrow up, PCWP. What is cardiogenic pulmonary edema? And it explains. It says because of heart failure, increased back pressure will cause fluid to leak through the capillaries into the interstitial spaces of the lung and then into the alveoli. And there's varying degrees of heart failure. So not every person with heart failure will have so much fluid in their lungs that it actually spills into the alveoli and they start coughing up all this fluid. So it varies. By increased back pressure, there's another word that you come across, and it's called hydrostatic pressure. So maybe draw a line where it says back pressure, maybe circle back pressure, draw a little line, and then write also called hydrostatic pressure. H-Y-D-R-O-S-T-A-T-I-C, hydrostatic pressure. So this hydrostatic pressure is increasing, meaning that there's so much pressure in the capillaries, it just pushes fluid right across the capillary wall. It can go into the interstitial space of the lung, or in severe cases, it goes into the alveoli. Write down that pulmonary edema is fluid in the interstitial spaces and alveoli. Pulmonary edema is fluid in the interstitial spaces and alveoli. Picture helps you a little bit. Up here is an alveolus, down here is an alveolus. You've got this tan color is at the interstitial spaces, and these oblong areas are like the capillaries with the red blood cells in them. So there's so much pressure in the capillaries, it pushes fluid out of the capillary and into the interstitial space. You see some of the fluid leaking into the alveoli. So this is what happens with left heart failure. We're almost done, right? Mm-hmm. All right, so there's other causes of pulmonary edema. What was the first cause we just talked about?
Left heart failure.
So a couple other things can happen that's going to cause fluid to come into the interstitial spaces. The first one, increased capillary permeability. I have some notes for you to write. Due to a massive infection in the body, so a massive infection in the body, and in parentheses, this is called sepsis. Yeah, this is called sepsis. S-E-P-S-I-S, sepsis. Blood pressure drops, so put BP with an arrow down. Fluid leaves the vascular spaces. Tissue edema occurs. Fluid leaves the vascular spaces and tissue edema occurs. So the body's response when there's a massive infection, the infection can occur in one area of the body and then get into the bloodstream. So strep throat, the bacteria can end up in the bloodstream. Urinary tract infection, the bacteria can end up in the bloodstream. And when it does, the body responds by having low blood pressure. The capillaries have increased permeability. I guess it's to get the proteins, the white blood cells, into the areas of the body that are infected. But instead of it just being localized, now it's the entire body is experiencing this. So with sepsis, you're going to have increased capillary permeability. Fluid is going to leak out. Another response is blood pressure is really low. Do you need to write anything else for that to make sense? Okay, and then for decreased plasma oncotic pressure, this is low protein in the blood. Proteins exert a colloid osmotic pressure. Colloid, C-O-L-L-O-I-D. These proteins exert a colloid osmotic pressure. You got that? Colloid osmotic pressure? Colloid osmotic pressure? Yeah, like a pooling pressure. And I just have, it means that proteins keep fluid inside the blood vessel. Proteins keep fluid inside the blood vessel.
Inside
the blood vessel. All right, so does that make sense? If there's low protein in the inside the blood, you don't have that holding protein that keeps fluid inside the blood vessels, and fluid will tend to leak out. So the patient won't be short of breath. You get an x-ray and you see they're in pulmonary edema. Why are they in pulmonary edema? And then you find out that their proteins are really, really low in their blood and everything is leaking out. And that's what's causing the pulmonary edema. Or they have a massive infection in their body. You get a picture, oh look, they have pulmonary edema. Well, is it from the heart failing? No, they have a massive infection and increased capillary permeability and all the fluids are leaking out.
So you should be put fluid leaking out?
So in both cases, it's a fluid. It's right?
This is the cause of pulmonary edema.
Causes of pulmonary edema. Mm-hmm. So it's not just heart failure, there's other causes. Would pulmonary artery pressures be elevated due to leaky capillaries from sepsis? So imagine the capillaries becoming leaky and everything's leaking out, and you're measuring pressure in the vessels. Do you think everything leaked out, the pressures are going to go
down, right?
A little, right? So sometimes they stay normal, sometimes they go down, but it's asking you, would they be elevated?
No.
No. So right, no. Would pulmonary artery pressures be elevated due to low oncotic pressure or low protein in the blood? So you don't have enough protein, everything leaks out, would pressures be high?
Low.
Or okay, sometimes they're normal, sometimes they're low. But it's asking, would they be elevated? So say no. Mm-hmm. Would pulmonary capillary wedge pressures be elevated? everything's leaking out, you wash the balloon. No.
Because in all three cases, there's nothing making the pressure.
Exactly. All right, and then this mitral valve, it narrows, it's mitral valve stenosis. It can occur when there's an infection in the body, some bacteria love to sit on the valves. It can be congenital, but somehow the mitral valve can become narrow. How does the stenosis influence pulmonary artery pressures? Ooh, we have to think about that. All right, so stenosis is narrowing. Blood is having a hard time getting through the left ventricle. What happens to back pressure?
It raises pressure.
Yes. So somebody who has mitral valve stenosis ends up having really high pulmonary artery pressures.
Because of the buildup of back.
Yes. And the last question kind of goes hand in hand with that. Would the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure be elevated? Since you have all that back pressure?
Yeah.
Yes. You did it! Woo! 5 to 12, and then at 12:30, the second year students will be here.